accordance with the Open Public Meetings Act, has given adequate notice of this meeting. All stand and pledge allegiance to the flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Councilman Chase. Alex Karazi. Ms. McIver.
Here.
Mr. Mettler.
Here.
Mr. Manzare.
Here.
Mr. Pettit.
Here.
Mr. Thomas.
Here.
Ms. Ragnow.
Here.
Mr. Mola.
Here.
Chairman Arsini will be here shortly. He's running a few minutes late.
Okay, we can proceed with the resolutions. ELN 15-00018.
Sweka, move the resolution.
Second.
Second, okay.
Mr. Karazi.
Yes.
Ms. McIver.
Yes.
Mr. Mettler.
Yes.
Mr. Manzare.
Yes.
Mr. Pettit.
I can't hold that.
Mr. Thomas.
Yes.
Ms. Ragnow.
Yes.
Mr. Mola.
Yes.
That's it.
I wasn't here for that hearing. I can't hold that.
All right, next we have the resolution on the master plan reexamination.
Move to approve.
Second.
Mr. Karazi?
Yes.
Guyver?
Yes.
Mr. Mettler?
Yes.
Mr. Manzare?
Yes.
Mr. Pettit?
Yes.
Mr. Thomas?
Yes.
Ms. Ragnow?
Yes.
Mr. Mola?
Yes.
All right, under discussion, we have the vouchers for planning board attorneys, Clark and Vignolo, the March retainer of $833.33.
Move to approve.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Thanks.
Excuse me, again, I hate to do this, but
if you want me to, if you feel more comfortable, I can call the roll.
Whenever the expenditure of money is concerned.
If you feel more comfortable, like it. Mr. Karazi?
Yes.
Guyver?
Yes.
Mr. Mettler?
Yes.
Mr. Anzare?
Yes.
Mr. Pettit?
Yes.
Mr. Thomas?
Yes.
Ms. Ragnow?
Yes.
Mr. Mola?
Yes.
And Councilman Chase has arrived. Councilman Chase, for the vouchers.
All right, next we have the extension of approval of the estate of Mary Piersanti.
Okay.
Yes, thank you very much, Madam Chairperson, members of the planning board, members of the public. My name is Francis P.
Frank, I don't think that's picking up for some reason.
Did you get this letter, Jim?
My name is Francis P. Linus, 21 Clyde Road, Somerset, New Jersey. I'm representing the estate of Mary Piersanti. Just very briefly, back in September, this board approved a minor subdivision. You have 190 days to record the subdivision deed. There are certain conditions that have to be met and fulfilled before you're allowed to record the subdivision deed. We're getting close to the deadline of March 24th. We were just notified that my client needs to post a performance bond. He's out there trying to get the performance bond. Once that's obtained, they'll sign off and we'll be able to record the deed. So we're requesting a 90-day extension for that subdivision to be allowed to record the deed.
Any discussion on this? Do I hear
I would move to approve the extension as requested.
I think the extension is okay.
Councilman Chase?
Yes.
Mr. Karazi?
Yes.
McIver?
Yes.
Mr. Mettler?
Yes.
Mr. Manzare?
Yes.
Mr. Pettit?
Yes.
Mr. Thomas?
Yes.
Ms. Ragnow?
Yes.
Mr. Mola?
Yes.
All right. At this time, we're going to open up the meeting for any public comments. This is not about the Hamilton Street management plan that we are going to be hearing tonight. If you have any general comments for the board that you would like to express, please step up and identify yourself and give your name and your address.
Benjamin Guy, 35 Patton Drive. I just had, because you guys are going over the master plan that that is there actually going on over the next year or so to actually come out. One of the things that I just want the board to actually consider, because it actually affects the town as a whole, is when you're actually looking at the master plan, the attendance zones for the school, actually having a conversation with the school about the attendance zones because of the expansion with Claremont and also with other housing developments that are coming up, not just on Hamilton Street, but also on Randolph Road and other things that are actually out there, actually how that's going to actually affect the town for transportation with the kids going around the schools, because one of the things that's actually might not be known to the town is that the when you guys actually do an expansion plan, it actually affects the attendance zones that are actually out there also for the school board. And I know that over the last probably couple of years, there hasn't been enough communication with the school board on actually joint talks. But because you're coming up with a master plan, I would like that actually to be considered exactly how that might affect the attendance zones for the schools, because it's a big deal for the kids that are in the community, actually how they're going to get around, because some of them can't afford certain things. And I know that as we expand the zone or the reach of the town with I guess housing or what have you, it's going to affect how the kids can actually get back and forth to schools. So having that conversation early enough to actually work with the school board on how that might affect their transportation issues or anything else, that's one of the things that I actually want you guys to actually consider at all. The second point is actually as the town expands and actually does more with housing in the areas, actually how you're actually going to be maybe looking at more activities for the kids that are in the community. I know you're working on park plans, but also looking at expanding the recreational services that are actually offered with the town itself. There's a lot of community groups that actually do a lot of good work here, but actually how you're actually going to do that and actually how the town can support that more so that you have a better community as a whole. Because as Franklin expands and actually adds more to its population density, you actually have to see how you're going to keep that brand and withstand that brand as far as how Franklin can work together as a community going forward at all. So those are things that I would actually like you guys to consider, because in the last plan, yes, you did have some things that were there, but there are some things that weren't addressed. And like I said, as you assess that and actually look forward, I'd like you actually to focus on that, because as you've expanded, there's been some neglect in some areas, and I would like you guys to actually consider those things going forward at all. So that is my little comment.
So I understand you better. Is your main concern about transportation to the facilities that are being planned?
It's not just that. It's because of the communication as a whole. The council handles one thing, but the Board of Ed handles another thing. And what has been done over the past couple of years is that there hasn't been enough joint conversations about how we can work together, because, again, the school board operates one way, council operates another way. And like I said, again, a lot of times we're spending money in double areas where we don't have to. And a lot of times we don't address issues because we haven't talked. We haven't talked about exactly what we've been doing. We've been working off a plan that is there, that is in stone or somewhat of a guidelines. But at the same time frame, how does everybody know what they're doing? Because, again, I don't know. You haven't had joint meetings. You haven't had joint meetings over the last couple of years to actually talk about different issues that have came up. So somebody's spending money here and somebody's spending money over here, rather than actually saying, hey, look, we'll partner up and do it together to actually spend money together to actually save the county, the taxpayers, more money as a whole. So that is my whole thing, is just having a better communication about both entities that the taxpayers pay into to actually support the town in a better light at all. And that's what my main thing is, to say, hell, how can we grow together rather than separate?
Because you're concerned with the coordination of the different boards.
Yes, I'm very concerned with that.
Working together to save money.
Yes, very concerned with that. Because, again, I don't want to be taxed anymore. Like, nobody wants to be taxed no more. I don't want to keep paying for, things that the school board says, oh, look, well, we got to pay for it because it's part of the school board budget. Okay, well, have you talked to the council and seen how you can actually work together to actually save money? No, you're just going to tax me more. I don't want to be taxed anymore. I want to try to work out a way so that you guys can actually work on better efficiency on taxing.
One of the things that we do have is, for instance, Ted Chase is our liaison. He's a member of the council, the deputy mayor. He was at an open space committee meeting where we get funding for open space park projects. Bob Thomas is the chairman of the zoning board. So in this aspect, we have different members that serve as liaisons to the different boards, and they do report on different activities. And of course, our council is concerned with the financial aspects, as well as Open Space Committee. So there is some overlap, but I agree. You have a good point. One of the things that's been suggested in the past has been sort of a summit meeting where your leaders can come together and discuss projects. Mm-hmm. And with that in mind, being efficient, yeah, saving money.
Yeah, that's
a very good point.
My job is just to be try to push efficiency as possible. Like I said, and again, that was one of the things that came up during discussion. I don't mean to take up too much time, but that was one of the things that came up that, again, during the master, when you look at the master plan itself, is that, again, you're supposed to be talking from both parties. It's supposed to be a working project because it's affecting the whole town. Well, so if we're not working together, then we're not following our guidelines.
Thank you for coming forward and bringing this to our attention.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else from the public that wishes to speak at this time?
Madam Chairman, seeing no one coming forward, I would move that this section of the public hearing be closed.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
At this time, our chairman has arrived, and I'm going to turn the meeting over to him.
Thanks, Sue. So we're at our one hearing tonight, right?
Yes.
So Benefit Mall is carried. Do we have to announce that?
Yes, yes.
Okay. So Benefit Mall, PLN 16-00001. Is going to be carried to April 6th, 2016, with no further notice needed. And so that brings us to the one.
Will be carried to April 20th.
Huh?
Well, hopefully we'll have it worked out and it'll be done administratively. But that's our hope.
Well, anyway, that's what we have to announce.
That's what we're hoping for.
Okay. Hamilton Street Management. So PLN 15-00017, carried from March 2nd.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, members of the Planning Board, members of the public. My name is Francis P. Linus. I'm pleased to represent the applicant this evening on a project in your Hamilton Business District. This particular piece of property is a 2-acre piece of property. It's located at 695-697 Hamilton Street. It's an application for preliminary and final site plan approval to construct a mixed-use apartment retail building, and we need only one variance, and it's a de minimis lot impervious coverage variance. Other than that variance, this is completely consistent with the regulations, the zoning regulations, and the spirit and intent of the Hamilton Business District. It's been a long journey to reach this board. Even before we filed the application, we've had many meetings with the township staff, preparing many, many revisions to the plans, even after we filed the application, and as evidenced by the chair indicating that this matter was postponed from the last meeting. We've been, again, meeting with the staff, and we think we've got it right this time, and we believe that we have a project and a plan, a final plan, that is worthy for your attention and hopefully your approval. I have three witnesses tonight, and hopefully they'll be brief. The first witness will be Jimmy Dumas. He's the applicant's architect. He's also a professional planner. Jimmy basically designed the project working with the applicant and the township staff. He's going to provide you with an overview of the project as well as providing some testimony as to the lot impervious coverage variance. Our second witness will be very brief, Mr. Deck. He's the applicant's civil engineer. You'll note as we go through the proceedings that we can comply with all the township engineering reports, but he's here to answer any questions the board may have. And then finally, we have Betsy Dolan of Dolan and Dean. She's our client's traffic consultant, and she'll talk about the parking and the site circulation, as well as any traffic impact. So without further ado, I see Jimmy has set up his exhibits, and with permission of the chair, we can proceed.
Go right ahead.
Okay.
Before you start, can you reposition those so that maybe put it next to the other one so that the public has a chance to see it? Thank you.
All right, Jimmy, would you give the board members of the public who are here the benefit of your background qualifications?
If I could just swear in first? I'm sorry. If you could raise your right hand, do you swear the testimony you're going to provide is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
Yes, I do.
If you could state your name, spell your last name, and give your address for the record.
Sure. It's Jimmy Dumas II, and it's Jimmy, not James. And my address is 24 Braxton Drive, Belmead, New Jersey.
Great. Thank you.
All right, Jimmy, would you give the board and members of the public who are here the benefit of your background, professional qualifications, and experience?
Sure, absolutely. I'm a graduate of Cornell University, where I got a Bachelor of Architecture degree. I've been a licensed architect since 1997, been a professional planner since 2003, and I've been in front of this board and many other boards over many years.
You're accepted.
And that would be for architecture and planning?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Jimmy, would you explain to the board and the public what your involvement is with this application?
Absolutely. I'm the architect and designer for the project known as Hamilton Commons at 695 697 Hamilton Street.
And in connection with your preparation of the plans and your testimony this evening, I assume you reviewed the HBD district zoning regulations?
Absolutely. Reviewed the Hamilton Business District zone regulations, and this project meets all of the criteria for that zone.
All right. Except for the impervious coverage.
Except for the discussion.
Right. Okay. And you visited the site on more than one occasion, I assume?
At least 20 times, if not more.
And you met on more than one occasion with the township staff to refine the development plans that are before the board this evening. Is that correct?
That's correct. We started meeting, I'd say, late last spring of 2015 up until early February of this year.
All right. I see you've pre-marked certain exhibits. Do you want to describe the site in existing conditions?
Sure. So there's actually seven exhibits, and I've marked them A1 through A7. And the first sheet is part of your packet. It is the title sheet, which essentially states that it's a mixed-use apartment and retail building, a commercial building that we use interchangeably. Arguably, it's located right in the middle of the Hamilton Business District. These are the either ends, and it's right there in the middle. So it's a prominent site. The site is roughly about 2 acres, and it is a four-story building that we're proposing. The first level would be commercial, and the top three would be residential.
And do you want to proceed with your exhibits?
Sure. So this first sheet, essentially what we're describing is the building overall, the description of the building. 31-bedroom apartments, 32-bedroom apartments, one studio apartment, which is a total of 61 residential units, and then there would be 10 retail or commercial units on the ground floor. The idea behind the building is for it to fit in scale with the rest of the neighborhood, which is predominantly two-story, sometimes one-and-a-half-story buildings. But the zoning allows for this to be a four-story building. And if we just go through the lot table real quick, it's a little bit more than 2 acres, like I've said before, and the property is 350 feet wide and 250 feet deep. And if we look through it, we meet all of the criteria for the lot and the bulk requirements, except for the impervious coverage, which I'll talk about in a moment. And that impervious coverage is actually 3% over what's allowable. So it's 88% versus 85%.
And that would be over the 2 acres, correct?
That is correct. So now the other item that is of interest, and my client has been able to agree to this, is the parking that's required for that site. So there's a total of 194 spaces that are required, and that's per the HBD zone.
Say that fast three times now.
HBD, right. So, and what we're providing is 116 spaces for the residential, which is basically the residential site improvement standard requirement, and we meet that exactly at 116 spaces. We have another 6 spaces that we are providing for the commercial portion. We understand that there's 78 that are required, but we'll have further testimony from our traffic and parking consultant who can tell us more about why this still works. In addition to that, we were able to provide 12 or maintain the 12 on-street parking spaces. So overall, we are providing 134 spaces for the site. Now, that difference of 60 spaces, the 194 required versus the 134, our client will be able to make the in-lieu contribution, which is part of the HBD zone regulation. So that one is marked A1, Frank. So that was really just the general description of the property and or the proposed project. And I'll just go into a little bit more detail, not to belabor it, because this has been really almost a year's worth of work. So I could easily stand here for 3 hours, but I respect your time. So I'll see if I can get through it in the next 10 minutes or less. There are 10 units, medical, not meaning more like a doctor's office. That's kind of the idea our client has. Retail, some spaces as large as 2,500 square feet, and smaller boutique type spaces that are roughly 500 square feet or so. The anchor tenant on the end, which is on Hamilton Street and Bayer Avenue, would be the pharmacy. And the pharmacy actually is a long time business that's been across the street, and they're looking to relocate here, and which is also the client for the project. So you would have an owner developer that also is invested in staying on the property for many years. So that's marked A2. Go to the next floor, second floor, the residential. Essentially, there's 20 apartments per floor. So the second floor, third floor, there's 20 apartments. And on the fourth floor, there are actually 21. And one of those apartments really is a studio apartment that would be for the on-site manager. Essentially, again, it's made up of 1 and 2 bedroom apartments that have state-of-the-art kitchen. Some have 1 bathroom, 1.5 baths, and so forth. And it has elevators, of course, and it's code compliant and will be ADA accessible, and the units would be ADA adaptable as required. This is gone now. And this is what it would look like.
And this is A4?
This is A4, correct. So it's very, how should I put it? It's kind of civic in nature. We're looking for something with durable materials, cast stone at the lower level with brick above. And then instead of making it an entire brick or stucco building, having what is called, it's made by Parklex, but it's a wood siding that is a commercial grade. It's used all over the world, and it really, I think, gives a little warmer feeling to the building. And actually, there would be 2 different colors that would actually make up the wood portion of the building. So this corner that we're looking at, this is Hamilton Street, and this is Bayer Avenue. A part of the landscaping plan, there are elements that are part of it that will engage the public as they walk past it, so it's not just this building that's sitting with no type of shrubbery or landscaping. You can see the trees indicated more for picture only, but we're planning on putting all new trees along Hamilton Street across the frontage of the building, and then a few more as you turn the corner around Bayer Avenue. Essentially, the way the rhythm of this works is that it's 2-3-2, the 2-bay windows, bedrooms, 3-bay windows are where the living rooms are. And so that's really the rhythm that plays out through the entire front facade. So that was A4. Let's see. And A5, excuse me. Let's see. A5, just a little bit more detail of the finishes. It's a materials legend. Again, talking about the brick, being more specific about the manufacturer and color, as well as the cast stone and so forth. Also, the signage meets the signage regulations. And here's a matrix that shows what's required, what's proposed, and all of what's proposed is less than what's required as far as square footage, linear footage, and size. So we meet the signage schedule all across the board from Medical 1 to all the way through the other retail spaces. And here's a section of how this would look. One other interesting thing about the building before I close is that it's, for the people who are more familiar with construction, it's a podium construction. So essentially from the ground to the first floor, it would be a concrete building. So this second floor is actually a concrete slab, or would be. And then above that, it's stick built or wood frame. So the idea behind that is it helps cut down on sound transmission, but also it allows for a greater floor to ceiling height for the retail tenants. And then you can still frame however you like on top of the slab due to the thickness. So that's one thing that's, I think, maybe a little bit more unique about this project in this part of New Jersey. And the last exhibit is A7. And it's a landscaping plan. So I'm sure as by now you're familiar with the building layout, and you have the parking behind the building. There's no parking underneath the building proposed. It was a safety, security concern, even though it had been mentioned, if not by my client, did talk with some other advisors who thought maybe we could do parking underneath the building. I didn't think it was really prudent to handle to do that. So that's why all the parking is surface parking.
Okay, Jimmy, there is one variance. We comply with all the ordinance requirements of the HBT district, except for one, and that's the impervious lot coverage variance. You want to address that as a planner and give the board the positive and negative criteria?
Okay. Absolutely. So one of the first things we talked about is the variance that's being requested is the fact that it's a lot coverage. With this design, it's 88%. What's required is 85%. So we're over by 3%. Now, the reason that we are over by 3% are mainly for two reasons, which we think are good and necessary for the project to exceed the required impervious coverage. The first one is really the space that we give back to the public. We easily could have made the building 300 feet across with very little articulation and at the lot line. What we've done is pulled the closest part of the building 5 feet off of the 0-foot setback, which is allowed. And we've also pulled the building as far back as 18 feet even further. I think this is maybe even 20 feet back from the property line. So from the curb to this front door, it's roughly about 30 to 32 feet. And we thought that it would allow for tenants or potential tenants to use the space maybe for seating, maybe for other types of planting or planters in order to soften this building, because the building arguably will be the biggest building on Hamilton Street, or one of the biggest ones. So this was an idea to make it not as imposing. So that's one of the reasons why we're over the impervious coverage requirement. The second are the aisle widths. The ordinance allows for 24 feet, and we're providing 26 feet. So if you think 350 feet, 2 feet, that's 700 square feet times two. So that's 1,400 square feet, which is almost 1.5% of impervious coverage. Our client agrees, and I agree with them, that it allows for safer maneuverability of the cars that come in and out. A lot of the pharmacy customers tend to be a little older, and we thought that it would make sense to give them as much room as possible as they're maneuvering in and out. And we also think that it will cut down on any kind of mishaps that might happen in the parking lot. So essentially, if we reduce this by two feet, and push the building all the way to the lot line, we would be close, and we figure this is a much better approach to the site. Okay.
So you've pointed out the C2 benefits for the variance. Are there any detriments that you see if the board were to allow this deviation from the requirement?
I know I do not see any detriments.
All All right, so on balance, do you believe that there's a net benefit, a better zoning alternative for all the reasons you've discussed to enable the board in their discretion to grant that one variance?
Right, absolutely.
Okay. Now, Jimmy, did you have an opportunity to review with our client and our professionals and the board professionals the Township Engineer's report dated March 4th, 2016?
Yes, I have been able to do that.
All right, and after discussions with our client and our civil engineer, we've complied with just about everything, and whatever is remaining, we can comply with. Is that correct?
We can and will comply.
Can and will comply. Okay. Now let's talk about the certain outside agency approvals and the status. DNR, Canal Commission, where are we?
The DNR, that was submitted back in early October of 2015, and we have not gotten a response just yet, but we have submitted to the outside agency,
okay,
among a few others.
And we've submitted to Somerset County Planning Board?
That is correct.
And we received a report, and we can
right.
comply with that.
Absolutely.
Conditions of their report. How about Somerset Union?
Yes, we've also submitted to them back in early October.
Okay. Now, we've also received some reports from township departments, and you're aware of the fact that the Somerset County Health Department has no objection to the project. Is that correct?
That is correct.
All right, and then we did recently receive a report from the Franklin Township Sewage Authority. Can we and will we comply with their requirements?
We will comply with their requirements.
Right. We also received a December 7, 15 memorandum from the Franklin Township Fire Prevention Bureau, John House. Can we and will comply with those requirements?
Absolutely, we will comply.
And the Franklin Township Police Department, Sergeant Hagman, can we comply with his November 18th memo?
Yes, we can.
All right. We haven't received any comments from the water department, though, right, to the best of your knowledge?
I don't think we have.
Okay. Now, in addition, this application was reviewed by the Environmental Commission, and the Environmental Commission pointed out that this is a desirable development for this location with no environmental impact.
That
is that correct?
That is correct.
Okay. Did you also have an opportunity to review Mr. Healy's January 5th, 2016 memorandum?
Yes, I have.
Okay, now that memorandum was issued back in January. Since January, have you had any meetings with Mr. Healy, and have we submitted revised plans?
Yes, we have. We've had discussions face-to-face as well as a few emails back and forth, and we have complied with all of his comments.
All right. So you believe we've complied with most, if not all, of Mr. Healy's comments as set forth in the January 5th, 2016 report. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Yeah, well, let me just... There's actually a more recent report, February 25th.
Okay.
And I could give it to you. I could give it to you. I think once you review them,
you'll see that.
I'm sure you're going to say that you can comply, because they're basically, it's working out a bunch of details of streetscape, you know, most of which, again, we've been dealing with the applicant's professionals over the last year, so. What's that?
All right, Jim, you want to take a quick look at that and then indicate that whether we can and will comply with any remaining comments of Mr. Healy?
Well, while he does that, so you're aware that, right, that I sent, or you may not be aware, that I sent your esteemed colleague, Mr. Lanford, back away to work on stormwater issues with another very similar application the last meeting for stormwater. And so I noticed you're in the same... Pardon the pun, boat. So,
same stormwater boat, right?
Yeah. So, I mean, you can certainly take your time, but you know, we'll hear tonight. We'll give you our comments, and you can come back when the stormwater,
Right. Yeah. I'm the planning board attorney in the borough of Watchung. When we get into this issue of one issue remaining, usually at the end of the hearing, one of the board members said, you know, it's a pretty darn good application, or it's not a darn good application. And we would, in this hiatus, if you will, for presentation of the last issue, sometimes a board member will raise his hand on a motion and direct the attorney for the board so as to save time for all concerned, that when you do come back with that one issue remaining, that perhaps a draft resolution would be ready to save some time. If this is a full hearing, which it is, and we have everything on the record here, perhaps that might be an equitable solution, a solution to make sure that the board is comfortable with the final approval, meaning we go back and we do whatever we have to do with stormwater management, and then we perhaps save some time on the tail end. Because it, as you well know, Dr. Orsini, it takes a long time to get to the board, a long time to get to the board.
Senior?
Mr. President, I think the only concern will be that perhaps the storm water management will impact the design and the layout of the building.
So we're not asking for a vote. We're not asking for a vote tonight. We're just asking for an indication that the board, but for the stormwater, would be comfortable with the application. Yeah, so that when we do come back.
And I think we've done this in the past, and the attorney has prepared it. And if we come to the next hearing in May or whatever, and God forbid that it needs to be changed, then you don't approve the resolution. We go through and we discuss it, and we have to go through that. But
well, there's something else I'd like to bring up, something else you have in common with Lanford's application, and it's lack of parking. And
they have all the parking. They don't need the variance.
Well, yeah, but before we go to that, well, Seal's point is separate. But I just want to hear from our planning board attorney on his level of comfort of doing what you're asking.
I can certainly work with the applicant's attorney and try to come up with a resolution for this board to consider at the next hearing of this application if the board were so inclined for me to do that. Certainly, as Mr. Dominich indicated, if there's an issue at the hearing and for some reason something comes up that requires revision, that may need to be addressed. Also, it'll be a question of how far into the future we go. If you tell me we're going to do it, you know, we're going to hear this in 3 weeks, I may or may not be able to get that in front of the board. But.
Right, right. Well, I've had preliminary discussions with Mr. Dominich, and it would appear that the May 6th meeting would be the meeting.
Well, yeah, I mean, I don't have a problem with it per se if my attorney didn't have a problem with it. It's just a risk, right, on both parts, right, that something could come up and you would be delayed further. But the benefit is that if it doesn't, you'll have saved a little bit of time. And I'm willing to make that.
We understand and would appreciate the accommodation.
Yeah.
Okay. I have a question. Mr.
That's all stormwater. Is it related to this? Because
it's related to the stormwater.
Okay. Well, why don't we ask your question, and then I'll get back to Seal, because Seal's point is different, but it should be heard.
We have two applications on Hamilton Street, and it appears they both have the same problem with the stormwater management plan or design or whatever. As Jimmy Dumas, the architect, said, they've been working on this for over a year. How did we get then to the 11th hour, and we still got the same problem with stormwater? It seems that there's a difficult problem. Something must be on Hamilton that's causing these gentlemen some kind of difficulty in compliance. I don't know what it is. I'm
well,
just curious.
Well, Vince can probably answer that question.
Well, I don't think it's a difficulty in complying. They just have not, as of yet, done their geotech.
It's a year later.
Yeah, and I'm just saying that they haven't done it. I can't tell you why, because I'm not the applicant. They just haven't done it, and typically this board does not grant an approval until they're assured that the project will work, because the geotech establishes a seasonal high water level, so we can have the 2 foot above, et cetera, with the board. So,
and I think that's especially important with the coverage variance, too.
Right.
Yeah.
Absolutely. So, you know, it is what it is. I don't know why it didn't get done. I don't know why it didn't get done with Lanford's, but, you know, it's the applicant's issue. This is their delay. So, you know. It is what it is. But it's a good question. Seal.
All right. I realize you're meeting your legal requirements by paying into the fund. Okay. But the site technically requires 192 parking spots.
And Ms. McGiver, not to cut you off, but we do have Elizabeth Dolan, who is our traffic consultant, and we zeroed in on the very issue that you're asking me the question for. And it is an issue. And she'll be talking about shared parking, et cetera. Okay. So that's the lady that you want to, that's the lady you want to question.
All right. Well, okay.
I have a tough enough time practicing law.
That's what I'm about to say. All right. The same thing is happening with the other site. What I'm foreseeing is this is going to snowball. Now, you're putting in retail. They're putting in retail. Retail, to be successful, requires adequate parking. Now, you said that you don't want to put parking underneath the building. What is the reason for that? Is there a good reason not to put parking there?
Right. Actually, what I testified about 10 minutes ago regarding not putting it underground is that there's a safety and security issue because it's...
I don't buy that. You know, I actually had the same question she did. I mean, there's plenty of evidence. You can go down to RPM, and they have parking underneath right off of Churchill. I mean, it's within the same... What security? It's not like you've got Fort Knox over there. You got medical offices. I don't.
You told me
I need a better explanation than that. Because then your impervious could go away.
Actually, the Board of Adjustment just approved a slightly bigger project with underground parking with no security issues or any other problems relating to being underground parking.
Well, let me also.
If there's another reason you can't do it, that's. I guess we'd like to hear it, but
I haven't heard a reason.
Well, another reason is just access. I mean, because all of the retail is at the ground floor, and all the parking is at the ground level as well, so that there would not be a need to go upstairs or even an elevator in order to get to the ground floor retail.
What?
But you can have. I'm sorry. I mean, you can have for the resident. You can have the parking in the ground floor,
yeah.
And which is 116. As I heard you had allowed 116, and then the rest of them for the retail, they can park it and they can do their business.
What I would suggest is, why don't we listen to the traffic engineer, hear about the shared parking. And then also just keep in mind again that as far as the ordinance, this does comply. And the allowable, this parking in lieu of is not new. It's been in the ordinance for probably 12 years. So even when we adjusted the ordinance last year, this was in there all along. So just keep that in mind.
We can't make a mistake.
No, I realize it's legal. But the point is, they're putting in retail stores that they want to be successful. And since other applicants are doing the same thing, this is going to snowball. There will be a lack of parking in the Hamilton Street area in the future.
And once again, not to stop you, but we do have, she's waiting. Okay. She's patiently waiting to get up here.
Okay.
And I hope she can answer your questions, and I think she will.
And I'm sorry, I have one. Quick question before we move to the parking.
I have one quick question.
I have a question.
Okay.
So you, several people do. So before we go, let's.
All right. First of all, I like your idea of providing space for residents sit and the street level. The question I had is that, are you going to be providing some sort of a bench or something like that so they can sit and. That's one question I have. The other question I have, the color, I like the color, but I'm wondering whether or not those color have looked at coordination with the color of other development in the area. And the third one is on in terms of your lighting, I really appreciate if you use LED, because not only is it gonna save you, but they look really nice too.
Sure. Okay, to answer your three questions. The first one regarding benches is that we have a one of our earlier exhibits. This is a standard bench detail, and where we're calling out benches. There's some in the back of the building, as well as on the side. And if it makes sense to add more, we can. But this is at least what's being presented as far as benches are concerned.
I guess I was talking about, when you were talking about that you move the building further so you can have spaces for the tenants to sit at the front part, didn't you say that?
Right. Well, this would be for the for the retail tenants, but it would give them flexibility in how this is used. So it could be benches. It might be an outdoor seating for an eating establishment. So the second question that you have was regarding color. And I don't know if it fits with other projects, but I know that these are pretty much earth tone type colors. And I think that if we have to go over it with the planning or with the planner to assure him that it's in harmony with the area, we definitely would do that. And then your third item regarding LED, the wall sconces that are outdoors, these are LED fixtures, as well as on the landscaping plan, there are... There are also LED fixtures that are on light poles in the parking area as well. So it's all LED in the parking as well as on the building.
Thank you. Bob?
Well, now two things. As to coordinating, this building sits next to what I've always considered to be a seriously ugly building. And so I hope that they would not coordinate with that. Now, you made me a little bit nervous when you mentioned medical as being a use for the building. You made me a little bit nervous when you mentioned medical as being a use for the building, because we've had these discussions about medical and on Peronica Avenue. And would you be willing, or would your client be willing to accept a stipulation that it seems that the thing that produces the most traffic and the most parking and the most problems are a laboratory, like a medical lab, like a lab corps. So would the client be willing to stipulate that one of the medical uses would not be like a medical laboratory?
I believe the client would be agreeable to that. He's mentioning that it is, he's looking at doctor's offices and not like laboratories of that sort. So if there is some kind of stipulation to that effect, I think the client would be agreeable to that.
Thank you.
And that saves me my question.
I only have one question left for Mr. Dumas.
Yeah, can I?
On direct.
I think for my question, he did answer it directly when you were talking about the lighting fixtures. I think I'm okay with it.
Okay.
Thanks.
Great. He's got another question.
All right.
Go ahead.
All right, Jimmy, finally, you are familiar as a planner and as the designer of this project with the purpose of the HD ordinance, right? The HBD ordinance, right?
Yes.
And it states that the recent amendments are intended to further the township's continued efforts to revitalize the Hamilton Street corridor by encouraging appropriate private investment and redevelopment in the area that is consistent with the township's vision for the area as an attractive, pedestrian-friendly, mixed-use Main Street area. My question to you, sir, is based on your testimony, do you believe that this project, as proposed, is fully consistent with the township's vision for the area as an attractive, pedestrian-friendly, mixed-use Main Street area?
Yes, I believe that it is.
Okay, I have no further questions of Mr. Dumas.
Ted.
Mr. Linus, are you going to have Mr. Dumas go over Mr. Healy's comments?
Well, let's save Mr. Healy's comments to give you a fair chance to read them since right. They're a new issue of February. Oh. And since you have to come back for the stormwater, we can address them at that time if you have. Or if you comply with all of them in the time it takes. I hate to do the rush job, right? So, you know, since you're going to come back anyway. Take your time to read them. If you agree, then all you have to do is say agree when you come back. Fair enough?
I took a look at it, there were actually six items. Mm-hmm. One of them was asking for a 3D rendering, which we have. There were a few others regarding benches, which we talked about, that there are benches, but possibly Mr. Healy would like to have a few more benches. So that's one of the comments. Another one, actually, down here.
Excuse me. I mean, I assume Mr. Healy's February report eliminated a lot of the information on the January 5th report and reduced the comments.
Yes.
We indicated to the chair and the board that we could comply with the January 5th memorandum. So therefore, if the February later memorandum has less comments, we can certainly comply with those comments. Is that fair to say,
that
Mr.
That is fair to say. We definitely can comply with.
Okay, that's fine. I just didn't want to rush you into not thoroughly reading what you just got 10 minutes ago and being able to fairly represent that.
Dr. Orsini, I can tell you that we have been involved with many, many, many meetings with the township staff, including Mr. Healy, Mr. Dominak, and Mr. Vega. And basically, we have, we believe we've satisfied or can satisfy all of those comments. And now to respond briefly to Mr. Pettit's question, which was a good one, where have we been over the past year? I was just handed a preliminary test pit excavation and seasonal high water table determination dated January 14th, which we did submit, but I guess Mr. Vega has not yet had the opportunity to. It's a preliminary report. There may be other items. It's in the works, so it's not that we ignored the geotech information.
To clarify, nobody said you ignored it. I just asked why it took so long.
Ah, okay.
I didn't claim you ignored anything.
Yeah.
I just don't like voting on stuff that I'm not sure satisfies the requirement.
Well, and you're not going to vote on it because evidently we have to come back, so you're not going to vote on it, okay?
Ten.
Well, I'm somewhat concerned because what Mr. Dumas has shown differs in some ways from the plans that I was given for review. For instance, the plans I was given have very slight setbacks in the front and a rather large patio behind. And of course, Mr. Healy had commented, why not have the patio in front where it could be an attractive extension for ground floor businesses such as restaurants? And now what you've shown is slightly more setback in the front and less patio behind. So I'm just not quite sure what I'm approving. And similarly, Mr. Healy asked for, and I would certainly ask for, trees in the islands in the parking lot, which these plans do not show. I may have seen them from this distance in the plans that Mr. Dumas put up, but he really hasn't addressed whether there are trees in the parking lot. Another point is, what is the vegetation along the north side of the parking lot that between this property and the neighboring property. The plans I have proposed a solid row of arborvitae. Mr. Ely suggested a more varied selection of evergreens. Now, is there now a more varied selection of evergreens there? You haven't addressed any of these things, even though, as I say, from this distance, it looks as if you may have addressed them, but you haven't spoken to them.
Okay, and I would agree with the last statement that you said, that I've not addressed it in this presentation. And there have been quite a few iterations of the proposal or the proposed project. So very well, what might have happened is that you have an older set of drawings that have since been updated. So the drawings that are for review tonight were drawn and dated February 1st of 2016. It's very well possible that you have drawings from December 22nd, 2015, or maybe even an earlier.
These are dated, received October 5th, so
October 5th. We're well beyond that, Dr. Chase.
So what I'd like to do,
I think what we'll do, especially since the board isn't voting tonight anyway, I mean, you're getting the overview of the project. I think what we'll do is the board will get a copy of the latest set of plans, and then at the next meeting, you know, at least you'll have everything before the meeting. And that's the latest set of comments that I know, you know, my report was based on, my most recent report. And I believe Mr. Vega's report was also based on that. And by that point, they're going to have the review of the geotech and the stormwater. So, you know, hopefully by that meeting, a lot of these issues will be taken care of.
Yeah, it would be good if we can get the latest before we hear them again.
Yep, absolutely. Yeah.
October 6th, yeah.
Jenny, before you sit down, did we submit this to the township, that this preliminary report?
It was submitted, however, as a part of the package. It actually was submitted prior to the last package that was submitted, I believe, on February 8th.
Okay. Okay, I've completed with Mr. Dumas.
I'm sorry, you
completed with Mr. Dumas. Perhaps the public would.
No, we'll do the public at the end.
Great.
So we'll go on to Ms. Dolan.
Very good. Mr. Deck?
Mr. Deck. If you grab the microphone. There you go. Do you swear the testimony you're going to provide is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
If you could state your name, spell your last name for the record, and provide your address.
Edward, middle initial S, last name Deck, D-E-C, 131 North Michigan Avenue, Kenilworth, New Jersey.
Super.
All right, Mr. Deck, would you give the board members of the public who are here the benefit of your background, qualifications, and experience? And you could have a seat, Ed. You know.
Oh, thank you. I'm a graduate of New Jersey Institute of Technology. I'm licensed as a professional civil engineer and land surveyor in the state of New Jersey.
You're qualified. Go
ahead. And I testified in front of here about 10 years ago.
Okay. Ed, you heard Jimmy testify that he worked closely with you on the site plan. Is that correct?
That's correct.
All right. And you heard Jimmy indicate that in conjunction with Mr. Vega's March 5th report, that the remaining engineering issues can be resolved. Now, we're not going to go into the engineering issues tonight because you're in charge of the stormwater management plan.
That's correct.
That you're going to be discussing with Mr. Vega, and hopefully by the time we reconvene, there will be no issue. Do you feel confident as a civil engineer that you can satisfy any remaining concerns on the stormwater management plan?
As a matter of fact, not only confident, but get more confident.
Here's a key answer, and we don't have it. Go ahead.
We had already done the revisions.
Okay.
So we are confident that we can.
So they're already in, and you're going to be discussing them.
Not into
them.
The town.
We Jimmy, you want to give him the other mic? That mic doesn't seem to be
turn it off.
Picking anything
turn
up.
That should be okay. Turn one of them off.
Yes, we had already received, reviewed the letter, made the applicable changes and revisions. And we will be submitting it to the township for their review.
Okay, and again, I'm referring to the March 4, 2016 Township Engineering's memorandum.
That is correct, yes.
Okay, and whatever is remaining on that, the few items that are remaining, you can satisfy them.
Absolutely, and just to one of the board's comments or concerns were that it might change the design of the site. It will not change the design of the site at all.
Right,
it had more to do with technical issues, which we addressed.
I have no further questions, Mr. Deck.
Board have any questions for this witness? Okay.
Okay. I know Ms. MacGyver's been waiting for this. Ms. Dolan.
Betsy will be good.
So, the only thing I really need to know, well, go ahead.
Just don't even let me swear somebody in. I have so few things to do here. Do you swear the testimony you're going to provide is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
Yes, I do.
If you could state your name, spell your last name, and give us your address.
Elizabeth Dolan, D-O-L-A-N, Dolan and Dean Consulting, 792 Chimney Rock Road, Martinsville, New Jersey.
Ms. Dolan is so well known to this board.
I understand.
All I need to make sure is her licensure is...
Did you lose your license on the way to the municipal building tonight?
I did not, and my PDHs are current as well.
Beautiful. Whoa, yeah. That's not bad. All right, okay.
Okay.
All right, Ms. Dolan, were you retained by our client to prepare a traffic impact analysis, the latest of revision of which is 12/30/2015?
February 4, 2016.
See, there we go. Time flies when you're having fun.
The so second revision.
You prepared it. Is that
yes,
correct?
Yes, I did. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Would you discuss your traffic analysis here? And then we'll get into the parking and the circulation.
Certainly. As has been presented, the application is for a mixed-use development consisting of residential apartments and retail space. We therefore focused our traffic study on the weekday evening and Saturday midday periods, given that there's a retail component associated with this. Those two time frames would represent the busiest traffic activity periods for the site. We generated trip estimates using the ITE apartment and ITE shopping center rates, and we did not take any special credits for the downtown mixed-use setting, or which sometimes can be credited. We didn't take any of those types of credits. We simply generated the numbers for the apartments. It's 37 trips during the evening peak hour, 32 trips during the Saturday peak hour. For the retail space, 90 trips during the evening peak hour and 120 during the Saturday peak hour. When we combine those volumes with actual counts that were performed at the intersection of Hamilton and Bayer, and we include background traffic growth for ongoing area development, we crunched through the level of service calculations, and we found that there's no changes at the signalized intersection, that the amount of traffic can be accommodated at that intersection and through the access points, which will be on both Hamilton and Bayer. The driveway movements will operate at acceptable levels of service, with the lowest level being a D coming out of the site onto Hamilton, and that's simply because during the weekday evening, traffic volumes on Hamilton are a little bit higher. But the site design allows for those vehicles to stage on site. So there's really no impact to the public rights of way. It's an on-site queuing, and the design that you've seen allows for a couple of cars to stack without any obstruction of on-site circulation. So the level of service calculations indicate that there's no negative impact associated with this redevelopment. One of the engineering comments had asked for an increase of the background growth factor, because as we went through these revisions, DOT did update their growth rates. So it went from 1% to 1.5% per year. I'll be submitting those revised calculations, but they don't show any significant change in the results. I think it added at most 15 cars to the intersection in 1 hour. So even if we did up the background growth factor, we still calculate acceptable levels of service.
All right, so with respect to that, you're referring to item number 78 in Mr. Vega's March 3rd, 2016
Yes, report. That latest engineering report. That was the one outstanding traffic impact issue. And as you've heard from our engineer and the architect, the site circulation has been established to provide full movement access on Hamilton as far from the intersection as possible. We're moving that bank driveway that exists currently. That will be eliminated, and the access is pushed all the way as far possible from the intersection. So that's definitely a benefit in terms of the access design. And then maintaining the access on Bayer, that's pretty basic on-site circulation pattern with two-way circulation aisles and parking. And you heard from Mr. Dumas that we're providing that 26-foot aisle width just for a little bit more driver comfort. 24 typically is used. We've used 26 here. Certainly, it's just a little bit more maneuvering area. So the site circulation and access system is certainly appropriately designed to promote safe and efficient movements to and from the site and to allow for the appropriate on-site circulation and movement into and out of the parking stalls.
Okay, let's start talking about the parking issue.
Yes.
Parking issue.
The numbers, I guess we've talked about a little bit, have been developed based upon the residential site improvement standard requirements for the residential portion and your ordinance requirement for the commercial portion. So there is a total requirement calculated of 194 spaces. That's comprised of the 134 for the, I'm sorry, that's the 78 for the retail and the balance for the residential.
And that's based on the ordinance?
That's right.
That calculation is based on the ordinance?
It's based on the ordinance, so 194 is the requirement, and the plan allows for 122 spaces on the property. 12 along the frontage on Hamilton, so that's 134. And as Jimmy explained to you, that leaves a balance of 60 spaces that your ordinance allows us to provide an in-lieu payment since we can't accommodate those on site. Now, while we do comply and can accommodate this in-lieu payment, I understand the concerns of the board because this isn't the first mixed-use application where this issue has come up. This is a new a trendy type of redevelopment with that convenience commercial on the first floor and then the apartments above. And when we prepare these traffic and parking studies for these uses, the obvious question is how much parking is appropriate. It's inappropriate to provide the total requirement for the retail and the residential because there is a shared parking phenomenon. And RSIS does say that in a mixed-use setting, shared parking shall apply. The combination of residential and commercial is a great mix for shared parking because the residential parking demand maximizes overnight and the commercial maximizes during the day. So when we take the required parking for each of the uses and apply shared parking, we don't get 194 anymore, we get 156. So it's still a little bit higher than what we are providing on-site and on-street in front of us, but that demand occurs during 1 hour on a Saturday. So that is the maximum concentration of theoretical parking demand based upon two spaces for each residential unit, roughly two spaces based on RSIS. So not all hours would require that parking load. There's a few hours throughout the course of a weekday and a couple of hours on a Saturday when we would exceed a demand of 134, our provision. If we were to go to a lower parking ratio of about 1.5 spaces per unit, I just quickly calculated we would go from 156 to 140. And if one space per unit were used, we would go down to 119. So then the question becomes, well, what's the right number? I'm not a planner, but I did read some of the zoning information, and it's my understanding that this is supposed to be like a Main Street redevelopment, encouraging pedestrian-friendly interaction. And so when I said earlier about trip generation not being credited for the proximity of residential to commercial, that also applies to the parking aspect of this, is that as this area continues to redevelop and there's more shopping opportunities and more residences, it's hopeful, I would certainly think, from a zoning perspective, as well as from a transportation perspective, that you're going to have residents walking to some of these nearby retail and commercial and maybe doctor's offices and so forth. So the goal, as I understand it, in terms of the transportation planning, is to promote pedestrian activity and have less reliance on the vehicle. That is supposed to bring down the parking, and I would think that some of that was considered as that ordinance was developed and the parking requirements were developed for this zone. I have had other applications where one space per unit to 1.5, 1.6 has been the accepted ratio. And this is a new sort of development trend, as I said, in terms of the parking history and statistics. But RSIS does say, and I believe your ordinance says too, that other parking ratios are acceptable based upon the development intention and the unit mix and so forth. The other aspect of this is that if parking is not provided, and for example, maybe it's a young couple and they have two cars, they may not be interested in this location if they can't be guaranteed two parking spaces. So some of the choice of the future residents, if they really need that type of parking, they're not likely to choose this type of setting if they're not guaranteed those spaces. I don't think that the applicant has a specific plan for assigning spaces, but we did talk about possibly assigning or reserving one space per unit. That is done in some other applications just to ensure that you have that. But again, in the mixed use setting, the idea is that the commercial will have a demand at a time when the residential demand isn't as high, the residential demand is overnight, and the retail demand is less at that time or non-existent at that time. So from my perspective, I think that this works very well. And if you, as I said, if you go with a ratio of about 1.5 spaces per unit, the shared parking analysis drops to 140 at the one busiest hour. And during most other hours, you'd have the 134 to satisfy that overlapping and shared demand.
You're taking into account the present conditions. You did mention that this area is being developed, and we are encouraging development of it. I don't know if Vince and Mark know right now what's planned in terms of residential and retail units
I think what the issue is that we have a conforming application regarding parking. I think in regard to this application, that's what we're dealing with. If the board is concerned about the overall parking for Hamilton Street, which you've addressed, one of the things we're doing in the next year is doing the master plan. So I think that would be the appropriate time for us to have this discussion. This applicant conforms 100% to the parking. We now have testimony that justifies, forget about even if there was a variance, it would justify that. So I think if we want to discuss that, we should discuss that during a workshop issue, that if you're concerned about the overall parking needs in the future with other developments. I think that would be the appropriate thing.
I'm bringing it up now because they have the ability to put parking under that building and lessen the demand for the on-street parking, which is going to be at a premium.
Well, I think what they meet the ordinance, and they've testified they don't need the additional. I mean, Ms. Dolan has testified that they clearly don't need it. So, and I'm not providing testimony for them, just saying that what you're talking about is an issue that we really shouldn't be discussing with this applicant. It's a discussion we should be having as a whole for this street or other streets in the township.
I don't know that you can say they don't need it. I mean, if you use the 1.5, you get, you know, you're only 20 short if you use one, or, you know, and like you said, which number to use. Unless you use the one and you're at 119, then you're not short. But so I don't know exactly which number to use. I take your point about the, you know, shared parking and the waning and waxing of demands for residential and commercial. I might disagree a little bit, but it comes to, if these are really doctor's offices and only doctor's offices in the first floor, that one could be ever so fortunate as to live right above their doctor. But, you know, if it was a laundromat, a convenience store, a pizza, you know, whatever, then yeah, sure. Those people are going to patronize those businesses. They're going to walk there. So I'm not sure doctor's offices has the same sort of relationship to the residential that those other type of uses will. That being the case, Seal brings up a good point, and it's the point we had. It's not related to your application, Francis. It's just, you know, the other one came up as well. And the deal is we're sort of in a catch-22 right now, in that we've changed the ordinance to encourage this type of development. We've had a number of applications begin to come forward and move through the process, and yet we haven't collected enough fees from the in-lieu parking to yet do anything in terms of the municipal lot. And Vince is absolutely right that we need to address that for the master plan and get a better understanding of what we're collecting, if we're collecting enough, and how we're going to use what we're collecting and make that absolutely a part of the master plan, and I support that 100%. So this isn't, you know, particular to you, and we're not trying to beat you up, you know, because you're no different than Peter's application was in terms of what you're providing and what's off-site. So I do like the idea of maybe, if possible, at least one assigned space for the residential. Would be nice to know that you at least get something for sure. And then, you know, feel like you said, if you're a two-car family, then you have a decision.
Yeah, and once again, when you're talking about the applicant and the ordinance, every applicant attempts to comply mm-hmm. with the terms of the ordinance and not seek any variances. And it's absolutely clear that this particular proposal with respect to parking not only is permitted under the ordinance, not only provides for this in-lieu contribution, but you have the expert testimony of Ms. Dolan. And I am in 100% agreement that the appropriate venue for an overall Hamilton Street parking solution is embedded in your master plan, which will then result in perhaps zoning ordinance that will affect not only the occupants and the voters and the people who live in these apartments, but certainly the whole area. What we're talking about is a well-conceived Hamilton business district, something that's needed in Franklin Township and has been needed for a long time. And when you have a developer who's ready, willing, and able to accomplish the objectives of the ordinance, then usually there's a good marriage, usually.
Questions to the board for Ms. Dolan, specifically in her testimony?
Yeah, just as a follow-up to what you just said, I agree totally with you, but at the same time, we should have this, rightly put it way, that whatever you have a sort of development, there should be an equivalent amount of planning for parking and movement of cars or even movement of people. So that's the point that we are trying to iron out here. Most of the people that have come before this board, they presented the same, almost the same argument that you are giving us tonight, but we still have to let them know that to plan and make effort to do what is right at the beginning of a project is the better way to go. Thank you.
Ted.
I'm somewhat concerned about Saturdays because if that's a peak time for retail business, but at the same time the residents are home, you may not have much sharing of parking, such as you would have during Monday through Friday. On the other hand, I'm less concerned for this development in particular because directly across the street is what's generally known as John's Plaza, even though John's is no longer there, with a very large parking lot that is not generally full. So I think that in practice, the parking need can be met here unless we get a use that draws an awful lot of parking across the street or a new use that occupies more of that space and leaves less parking. And really the bottom line is we aren't going to know how many parking space the residents of these several buildings that we're bringing in along Hamilton Street, how much they occupy and how much the businesses require until they're in place. I really think we have to fly a little bit blind here. And as I say, for this particular development, I'm somewhat less concerned, but I'm also going to inform the council that this is something the council ought to start thinking about for this area as well as the planning board.
And just to confirm that you're absolutely correct that Saturday the shared parking doesn't work as well as it does on the weekday, and the numbers that I spoke to tonight really are for midday Saturday. That's when it's most constrained. So we did do it for both a weekday and a Saturday.
Yeah.
The one thing that I think you might want to think about, the other two applications that we had on Hamilton Street, as other members have said, this issue was brought up on both. And the question about shared parking was brought up in particular. And on both of those applications, the applicant had indicated or reserved a certain number of spaces for the residents and then had open parking in other areas. So, for example, the one that had the underground parking that went before the zoning board, the underground parking was reserved for residents, and then the two surface spaces were open. The other one that came before this board last month, there was some spaces in the, I think, in the back that were going to be reserved. So you might want to think whether you have an answer today or perhaps think about it when you come back in May you know, perhaps there's some certain spaces, you know, for example, maybe the spaces that are immediately in the back, you know, that immediately adjoining the building, you know, perhaps those are the open spaces, and then the three rows in the back are reserved for residents or something similar to that. You put some thought to that and come back with a proposal for the board to think about.
Oh, and the other thing, I don't know whether you've addressed, is the possibility of parking along Bayer Avenue.
I think it's too narrow. I wasn't at the meetings, but I think Jimmy was. He might be able to speak to that.
Right. We were at the meeting there to talk about parking along Bayer Avenue, which we thought possibly, even talking with the planner, that maybe there was five spots that could be, that we could add to the parking that we already were proposing. The challenge was that it would move the center line of the street, and it also would, it was really not wide enough in order to accommodate the parking on that side. And I believe that one of the, I think it was the town engineer, Vince, that
it was both the police and the township engineer that I agreed with that.
Yeah, township okay. Staff looked into that, whereas it did work on the other one, it wouldn't work here on Bear.
Sure. Also, another quick comment, and was able to talk with the applicant or the client here, is that regarding the medical, which we have established our doctor's offices, that it's my understanding that their hours would be limited just during the week and not on the weekend. I know it's just a few retail spaces, but that they would look to limit that as a stipulation in addition to the comment regarding no laboratories of that sort.
Doctors sometimes have a lot of people in the waiting room. It depends on the individual doctor and how well they're able to keep to their schedule.
So does anybody else have any questions? We'll open to the public.
Yes. As a member of that community, I live like two or three blocks from this location. I'm glad to see we having development coming to our area because our properties lost a lot of value during the recession. With parking, I guess we're going to find out, you know, we're going to learn. But I believe there's a lot of parking in front of this development that can't accommodate more, because I go there on weekends, and most of the weekends I have to go park across in that other parking lot. And I would say most of the time it's like maybe 40 or 50% full. So I believe it will come out okay. No. But I'm glad for the development that's coming to our multi street, because it's long overdue.
Okay. Can we make a motion to open to the public?
Mr. Chairman, I would move that we open the application to the public for comment.
Seconded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Meeting is open to the public for comment on this application. Anybody like to come forward? Yeah, can you give them that mic?
You got it. If I could have you raise your right hand before you start, do you swear the testimony you're going to provide is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
No. Yes.
There we go. If you could state your name, spell your last name, and give your address for the record.
Pat Giannotto, 602 Hamilton Street, Somerset, New Jersey, chairman of the Hamilton Street Advisory Board. I'm grateful to see this project come in here. This is something that we've been looking to get in there. It's a great thing. The owners are in town already. They're business people, and I'm pretty sure they're really figured their parking out already, because they want to make their customers happy. It seems like they've met the parking requirements. A lot of discussion about it. It's something that's on our books already, that it's approved. Okay, and again, future discussion, I agree with everybody that's said so far that this should be, if there's a problem with it, we'll need to address that. And there was one other thing I had to say. I just think this is a great project, and this is something we really need down on Hamilton Street. Thank you.
Hi, Timothy Kelly, 193 Wilson Road.
Swear you in real quickly. Mr. Kelly, do you swear the testimony you're going to provide is the truth, all truth, and nothing but the truth?
Yes.
Perfect. If you could state your name, spell your last name, give us your address.
Timothy Kelly, K-E-L-L-Y, 193 Wilson Road. I'm also the vice chair of the Hamilton Business District. First, I would hope that we can pass this. Once again, this is another project that Hamilton Street needs. We, as the Hamilton Board, we do understand the parking concerns. We actually did talk about it at our last meeting. I guess one thing we should realize is these projects that are coming up are actually on like the biggest pieces of properties that we have on Hamilton Street. I don't really see too many big projects like this coming up in the future, because you would have to buy almost 10 lots to ensemble a piece of 2 acres of property. This property just happens to be, you know, an old bank and an empty lot, so they were able to put together such a big project. Part of our thing with the Hamilton Business District was we're kind of copying the stuff from New Brunswick, which is a lot of college, you know, it's smaller apartments, college housing, housing for Robert Wood Johnson, St. Peter's Hospital. We have been in contact with Rutgers University about getting shuttles up to Hamilton Street. We also have a park and ride at the old St. Peter and Paul Church for Robert Wood Johnson and both St. Peter's. So, you know, people can ride their bikes down there, you know, get on the buses, get on the shuttles to go to the hospitals. You know, we're also hoping that the commercial aspects of these will be used by the people in the neighborhood. You know, not only the people that are upstairs, but there's also, you know, a big community in that area that could walk to these places. But we do hear your concerns about parking, and, you know, we are going to try to, you know, work on that at our next meeting. That's all. Thank you.
Thanks. Anyone else wishing to speak on this application?
If I could just have you raise your right hand, ma'am. Do you swear the testimony you're going to provide is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
If you could state your name, spell your last name, and give us your address.
Carolyn Smith, S-M-I-T-H, 25 Parkside Street. And I really hope that you approve this project. I've been a resident of Franklin for over 50 years, and it's a wonderful thing to see some new development come into the area. And the one thing that I've noticed about the Township Pharmacy is that they hire people in the neighborhood, and it's so much needed that we could add some jobs to this area. So I really hope that you approve this development. Thank you.
Hi, sir, if you could raise your right hand. Do you swear the testimony you're going to provide is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
If you could state your name, spell your last name, and give us your address.
Brantley Williams, last name W-I-L-L-I-A-M-S.
And your address, sir?
324 Ralph Street, Somerset, New Jersey.
Great. Thank you, sir.
I'd just like to say, that area, that business area on Hamilton Street, it can use something like this. I mean, business hasn't really developed in that area for quite a while. So all I want to say, I think it'd be a welcome addition to the area. Thank you.
Thanks.
Mr. Chairman.
Oh, wait, here we go.
Snuck in on you. If you could raise your right hand for me, do you swear the testimony you're going to provide is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
If you could state your name, spell your last name, and give us your address.
My name is Lois Marie Pena, P E N A, and I live at 54 Henry Street in Somerset. Oh, I say, wow, I can't believe this could be done here in Franklin Township. I've lived all my life in Franklin. Not only this will boost the morale in the Franklin Township area, more job openings coming in for the retail store and also appointments. And I hope you people accept it. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Gary,
there we go. Sorry about that. Thanks. Do you swear the testimony you're going to provide is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Great.
Gary Chrisman, 751 Hamilton Street in Somerset, Chrisman. I've been a businessman on Hamilton Street for 48 years. Manu's a great guy. He'll definitely do everything. And every time a new store comes in, brings stores, it helps everybody on the street. Brings business. I get a little bit. They get a little bit. My customers come in. They go to his store. They go to my store. It helps everybody. So if you can pass it, that'd be great.
Thank you. Yeah. You can come back up again.
I don't know if you want to let him do that, you know.
You have to shine you now.
The other thing that I was thinking of was the stormwater situation. We went through that with the last applicant, and we're going through that again. It seems like to me, I mean, I'm not an expert on that, but we've had somebody testify that the property will be able to do that without any greater impact or changing it that much here already tonight. We have an expert at the township that's verifying everything. And if the person at the township is, I guess, our township engineer or something, if he says, yes, it's okay and it works, why do we keep making the people come back again?
Well, that's the thing. They don't have the calculations. They don't have it all done yet.
I understand that, but or is the board going to go through the calculations, or they're going to rely on the expertise of the engineer?
No, we'll rely on him.
My point is that every time you have to come back again, it's like another push backwards and start forward.
I want to make it clear that typically the board advises staff not to have applicants even come to the board until they have the information. We want this application to continue to move forward, so they're giving us everything tonight, and they're not being delayed, because the critical path is them meeting the conditions. So they're going to give us the information, and getting to the board is really not the critical path. The critical path is them meeting the conditions. So they're not going to be delayed in one moment, one second at all by coming back to the board. Like I said, typically this board has directed staff that if we do not have the geotech, and if they do not, the board doesn't want to see it.
Right.
They're allowing these to move forward as an exception to that, because we want them to move forward. The chairman and the board have directed us to allow us to do that. So this is an exception to that.
Okay, but that's a good point. Sitting back there and listening, I didn't know that. Okay, and I'm going, man, this is really, if that was me up there, I'd be so upset that I can't get this approved tonight. I want to get this done. I want to build this project. I want to spend millions of dollars out there on Hamilton Street. These guys aren't letting me do it.
I've already talked to Jimmy. You know, when they're ready to submit their construction plans, they can do that concurrently. So if they're ready in 6 weeks or 2 months to submit their construction plans, they can do that to construction while they're waiting to come back to the board. Because the township wants that, the staff wants it, the board wants it, the council wants it, you want it. Right. So we're doing everything we can to keep it moving forward.
Okay, you made me feel better. I'm good.
I mean, and to be honest, the applicant's been working with this diligently for a year. I mean, you really can't commend them enough in how diligent they've been working with us and working with staff. We've met with them, I don't know, Jimmy's been there a dozen times, so.
Yep. Thanks, Vince.
I'd like to make it clear, I'm not against this application. I want it to be approved. I will approve it when they come forward with all the information that they're required to provide. What I want them to be is not only successful in the near future, I want them to be successful 5-10 years from now. I'm anticipating that the Hamilton Street renovation is going to be a big success. You're going to see a lot more applications coming through for the Hamilton Street. And I'm picturing what's going to happen 10 years down the road. But that doesn't mean that I won't approve what they're coming through with tonight.
So what we want to do is...
Let's just go.
I'm just sorry.
Seeing no one else coming forward, I would move that the public hearing on this application be closed.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
We're going to carry this, Frank, to the 5/4/16 without further notice.
5/4, that's first meeting in May?
Yep.
Without further notice?
Yep. That was what we want to do, right? We'll come back and by then you'll have everything done and perfect.
Do you need an extension?
If we need it, you just send us, you know, just send us something saying that we need that. That'll be fine.
And I think you've received all the feedback you need and what you have so far, which is most everything, 99% of it, and pretty good indication.
Yeah, and just a reminder, I think we do need a newer, the most updated copy of the plan.
Yeah, we'll make sure that the board has that.
Good. And again, I'm not trying to delay anything, but we have a responsibility to have had the newest thing in our hands.
And Mr. Vignola will put his hand within the next 6 weeks to draft something?
Or? Only because you said my last name so well.
To further advance and
back
and satisfy the board of all their concerns. Yeah, I think there's a low risk to doing that, yeah. All right, thank you very much.
Surprise.
Thanks,
Fred. Mike? Oh. I just wanted to just take this opportunity to thank the community members who came and expressed support for this project. As one of the community members, believe me, we all would like to see the successful development in Hamilton Street. So rest assured that we do whatever is needed, and we do our best to support these projects.
Additionally, the fact that it's going to contribute to the economic well-being of that area is a plus. And I want to urge you guys to continue your good work. Thanks.
Okay, so we have a couple of work session items. Before we, one work session item, but there are a couple of things this application brought up that I think I want to direct staff and get the board's comments. So one thing that new board members may not know, and clearly Pat Gennato didn't know, is and the old board members will know, that we have devolved times to, you know, talking about diameters of pipes and such that I don't feel qualified. Maybe Jim Pettit is, but maybe he's the only one. So that's why I've always directed the staff that unless the application is like really complete, we don't want to be hearing it. So I think that was an exception tonight and one of the reasons why the stormwater calcs weren't done and then, you know, we heard the rest at risk. But in general, just so the new members know, that's why we really don't, you know, if you get asked, I mean, I don't know about you, but I don't feel comfortable making judgments about engineering things and I don't feel comfortable just saying work it out with staff. You know, and then it changes the plan. So it's better to do it right the first time, even if it takes a little bit longer. Second of all, with regards to plans, I think it's, not to affix any blame, but I agree with Bob. It makes us look unprofessional, who's ever fault, or not fault is the wrong word, but who's ever responsibility it may be. We've gotten some of these sets of plans for 745, and for this one, probably back in January. They've been sitting in my car. I went to my box. All I get is this little thin pack, and I'm like, damn, I forgot it. It wouldn't have mattered because it's from October. So let's try to get the applicant. It's probably the applicant as well, maybe not furnishing enough copies. I don't know whatever happened to that system where we're all supposed to use our computers and get in. Well, what came of that, where we could get that information real time and not have you print out or the applicant print out anything. Let's get that working. We're all literate enough, mostly computer literate enough to do that. But at least
literate or illiterate? Illiterate.
I mean, even if it's a matter of having your computer project something up there for us, that we have the most recent CAD stuff that's up there, even if I could bring my work computer here, hook it up online, and I'd be good to go, and probably a number of other people could too. No offense intended, but maybe that doesn't go for Bob.
No, it doesn't.
So I wanted to say that in the gentlest and kindest way possible.
I think we're just
Bob Metler.
I'm older than Bob, it's just right. For me.
So, it's all right. All right.
You could go and project it up there for us in real time if it's so you don't have the. I don't want to burden you guys with running off copies of and, you know, wasting trees, which we're going to ask people to replant.
But Mr. Chairman, I think that involves all of this paperwork, but I don't think I have or anybody has a computer that can print this out unless you work in an engineering office. So for the latest maps, we actually have to have the paper.
That's a good point. Yeah.
Yeah, my understanding is that the boards are going to get the first round of iPads that the council got, and the council just got the second round of iPads.
We need them.
And that, but you're not going to have them to take home. You're going to have them to look at, as Bob said, the 8.5 by 11 material here. And the big plans will still be in the box,
right.
And the 8.5 by 11 material will be sent to your home computer, presumably with paper copies for Mr. Metler, maybe Mr. Pettit too.
Only because somebody hacked my computer and it's completely shot, so I'm dead. Right now I'm dead.
Oh.
No computer whatsoever.
But I mean, even.
But is that the plan, Vince?
Yeah, it's all right. That's what we've been told, that we're going to have those so that the zoning and the planning board can use those at the meeting.
But even at the very least, what one could do, right, if there's ability, right, up there to project over there.
Yeah.
We get one computer in here and project what we need, even if it's just the 8.5 by 11 stuff. There are drawings sometimes in there or whatever. I don't know if those huge things can be reduced in any way or I mean.
Well, we get everything in a digital format.
So you get everything in a digital.
Yeah, we're required to get everything in a digital format now. So it's just a matter of IT figuring out a way to give us access so that one of us, whether it's Mark or myself, can switch the one up there and however that needs to be done.
Yeah, I mean, let's really try to work on that, because when we do a disservice to the applicant when we're not looking at their latest thing,
right.
And then we do a disservice to us as well, and it makes us look unprofessional.
May I make one comment? One of the other problems we had it for the 27 years that I was the engineer, was that we get these rolls of drawings with 57 sheets, and the planning board, frankly, doesn't need to get copies of all of the standard Township details, which were 25 of those sheets.
Yeah. Yep.
What they should be getting is the parking plan, the site plan,
good point,
the architectural plan, landscaping plan, the things that the planning board, like somebody brought up about the drainage. You don't need to get the drainage pipe plan, the size of
that's a great point.
No, I tried to sell that many years ago, and I got killed by a councilman because he told me I was trying to interfere with the workings of government or something. I said, I'm not trying to do that. I want to save paper.
Is that person still on council?
No.
Oh, then we don't need to worry about it.
He may be long dead. I'll be joining him soon. But no, in all seriousness, it wasn't Joe Martin. It was a Republican, a real Republican. Not a believe Republican. Which is false. I'm bringing up old wounds. If we're going to do that, then maybe the staff, we should talk to the staff about what particular plans of the entire set of plans does the planning board need to have a copy of.
No, that's a good point. And we don't need the outflow detail and the
profiles. The profiles of the sewer line and all that. The staff reviews that, as you said earlier.
Mm-hmm.
We rely on the engineer. He'll give us the stormwater management. He'll make the comments when it satisfies him and it satisfies the planner and it satisfies. That's all we need from them is their report. They're going to deal with all the detail.
Yep.
But to get those drawings, you know, and some of them are, like you said, they're 27, 37 sheets of plans.
Yeah.
Of which maybe 20 or not even that many, 10 might be something the board wants to see.
Yeah.
You could say the same thing for the zoning board, too.
Yeah.
And I would think you're going to save an awful lot of money with paper that doesn't need to be destroyed because it sits on my back seat.
Yep, like, my back seat, too.
And
I forget it.
What I suggest is why don't we go back and we're going to talk with IT and find out where we are as far as some of these things. My understanding is that the plan is that sometime soon site plans are going to be up on the website. So, you know, for example, perhaps what you get is reduced plans, a copy of the few important ones. Maybe we incorporate that into the staff reports in some way. And then you can always go online and look at the bigger
plans.
That
might work.
If you have a desire to look at the size of the orifice of a drainage line, you can look
orifice.
At that.
I don't want
really?
To name but,
orifice.
But, meaning but, PG.
But,
wow.
but then you don't have to make.
These are PG, Mark.
You know, 50 copies of, or 28 copies of a 50-set plan.
The only one who wants all 50 pages is Carl.
So why don't we look into that, and perhaps maybe at a future work session, Mr. Chairman, we can go over.
Yeah. What do you think is essential and what isn't?
Yeah,
really?
Mr. Chairman, maybe at a future work session we can go over, okay, board, what do you want?
And then after
we have a chance to look into it.
Work sessions. Another thing I would like to see us discuss is the, in lieu of parking fees, how much we've already accumulated.
Very little.
What a lot currently goes for in the off Hamilton Street business.
Well, those are two separate things because right now the ordinance says that we can charge what it costs to create the parking space. If you want to change the ordinance that it's the parking space plus the property, we'll have to add that. So that's a discussion you may want to have. Right now, it's just to create the parking space. It's not
the
property.
We don't even know. I don't know. And maybe other board members know, but I don't even know what we collect.
It's $2,500 or something like that per space.
Well, you know, it's a good problem to have because this means this ordinance change for this Hamilton Street Business District has been successful and people are wanting to build these type projects. So, understood. And we can't keep beating up applicants because they do the in lieu. But I think, you know, Seal's right, is we need to understand what it is we're collecting, when it is projected that we'll collect enough to do something, and whether we do need to increase it, and whether if increasing it, or you know, when does it become cost prohibitive for an applicant because we don't want to discourage the development.
Exactly.
So we need to understand all of that, and I have a very, I wouldn't even go so far as to say, damn, I have no understanding of what any of that is. So I think at a future work session, and I don't mean next year where we do the master plan, but like soon, we should get that information and at least start conversation.
I'd like to definitely see that happen because I don't think discussions like we have had the last couple of times are very productive. We have an area of town that nobody's built a new building in the last 30 years. We designed the ordinance or contributed to it for parking. These people are coming in, they're meeting all the standards. End of story. If we don't like it, we need to talk about it, figure out what has to be done, and do it. But it makes no sense to beat people up in public when I probably get the feeling that we need some of those positive comments from the public, or they're coming because they probably pick up vibes that we're going to reject these things because of the discussions on the parking, which really, if they meet the standards, I don't like it. It's irrelevant tonight.
I think we're beating ourselves up more than we're beating up the applicant. Yeah. We should have done something about it.
Yeah.
I think
one point is that I've heard the price of land on Hamilton Street is already going up because of projects like this.
Absolutely.
And, you know, it may remain continuously out of reach of the fund, even as we bring in funds to develop parking. The other point is, and I don't know how completely this is true, but that if we had municipal parking lots, that we'd have to have a municipal parking authority.
We would want to do that, yes.
Well, that depends on how you're going to bond things. Most times when you set up authorities, it's to allow you to have more flexibility in your bonding for long-term payment of debt. That's why they set up the sewage authority. Franklin couldn't have been, when the sewage authority got set up, is because the council at the time had bonded up to their limits, but we needed to put in sewers. So they said the only way we're going to do this is set up a separate authority. The Township of Franklin could have never had a sewage authority and built their sewers themselves, but they didn't have the bonding capacity. I've lived here 50 years, so I'm telling you, I know the history.
The most important thing with the whole parking issue is that I think we can have a nice conversation. Mm-hmm. I think Ted's point that he said about a half an hour ago, until they build these and we see, I don't think we want to make changes, because there is no parking problem on Hamilton Street right now. Absolutely not. And I think we need to see these three developments that are going to be built in the next year or so are not going to create a parking problem. I think what we're going to have to see is the effect that they have. Based on that effect, then we can make a determination, and we're going to have time to do that.
No argument with that.
We're going to have time to do that. So we can have our discussions, get that information. Once they're built, we can take a look and we can analyze that, and we'll have plenty of time to address it before there's any changes now.
I think we're just talking about gathering the information, because none of us has an understanding of what it is we're charging or what it might cost to do something.
Mike? Hmm. I guess, Vince, if we are collecting money for the parking purpose, I think it would be great if we buy some land in that area with the money that we're collecting.
Well, we don't have anywhere near enough money to buy any land.
Well, then we can at least get something and maybe either raise the money so we can have it, or as we are expecting down the road, that money to come to pay it up. My concern is that if we believe that the parking is not going to be an issue, why are we even getting the money from people?
I think everything you're talking about is the discussion we need to have.
Yeah.
Yeah,
because we don't know that we need parking.
Right,
and we don't know that we don't need parking. I think the board needs this information to start discussing it, and then when we see what happens, we can plan accordingly.
Well, I guess the point I'm making is that if we collect the money, let's buy the land before the prices go through the roof. Do we can afford it? I don't know who makes that decision. I agree that's the right thing to do.
I agree wholeheartedly, but until we get the information and we determine that we need to buy land, we don't want to buy the land. So we need to make that determination first, which is the first step, is what Mike said, is give you all the information and start the process.
Yeah.
You got to designate something now, get a plan. Well, at the master plan, it's time. I'm not saying do it tomorrow. But we've got to take an action, because by the time we get around to seeing how everything goes, and let's say it goes badly, right, it may be too late, and there may be no land available, or it'd be so. If we follow the lead of New Brunswick, take all the new stuff they've built in New Brunswick, and what have they built? Underground parking, the first three floors of some of those buildings are parking, and all the fancy apartments, the $2,000 unit apartments are above that.
Let me tell you something.
If
there becomes a parking problem and we don't have it, we could change the ordinance where they don't get to buy the spaces.
The only problem is there's a time limit. You're operating in a time. We can't wait. We're going to have to take some risk on our part. We're the township. We have to take some risk. We're supposed to be the planning board. We can't get caught with our pants down when it's too late, we can't afford to.
And I'm agreeing with you, and that's why we're saying we're going to get you all the information. I want to caution everyone to start saying, well, we need to buy land, right? The best thing that could happen to that street is that there becomes a parking problem. And that is,
that's philosophical.
Well, yeah, I mean, in principle, it's a good problem to have, but it's not a problem we want to create.
Yeah, we don't want to create.
I mean, it's good that this is successful, that clearly the ordinance change has worked to encourage the type of development we are hoping.
It's developing nicely.
Anyway, let's not have the work session now. Let's commit.
Yeah, that's the work session.
Let's commit within the next month to getting the board. Can it be done in a month? Get the board the information.
Oh, absolutely.
Put it in our packets. Let's have it. Let's schedule a work session to start discussing it, that the board can get a look at what we're collecting, what a parking spot costs, because I understand that you can make spots on Hamilton Street, and that's the cost of, say, striping and curbing or whatever that you're collecting and not buying the land. But, you know, let's just understand what we're dealing with. Okay. Let's move on to the historic,
I want to just make one comment, which is not about parking.
Okay.
If you read Julio Vega's report, there's a point at which he says the site is located within a high pollutant loading area in accordance with NJAC 7:8-5.4. Groundwater recharge is not recommended. So really, the impervious surface cover is sort of beside the point, because it's not recommended to have groundwater recharge anyway, which in effect says we don't need to worry about that variance.
True.
No, that may be.
But we might even.
Well, it wasn't the 3% impervious that, you know, yeah.
Yeah, but we do want to have some non-impervious that they plant trees in.
You know, Peter brings up the point. They're not here, so we should not discuss the application. You know, if you want to bring that up or ask.
I was bringing it up really as a general point.
Let's move on to historic.
Mr. Chairman, what you have before you, we emailed it to you, is some rather minor modifications to the Historic Preservation Advisory Commission ordinance. 3 years ago, we applied for certified local government status for the Historic Commission, which enables us to do certain reviews and apply for certain grants. As part of that review, we needed to make certain changes to the ordinance, and I'll go through them very, very briefly. On page 2, we changed the definition of historic district. It's just a technical change. The CLG people didn't want us to use historic district within the definition of historic district, so we changed it. All through this 20-something page document, they also wanted us to stop referring to everything and saying Historic Preservation Commission. They just wanted us referred to commission, so we made that change like 40-something times through this ordinance. It was a technical thing. It was just easier to.
So what changed basically?
Is commission.
That's what I'm going through. We'll get to the next page.
Oh, you mean did anything substantive change?
Yeah. No.
There's only a couple things that substantially change.
Well, that's what we need to look. The wording is, you know, that's the wording.
Page 15.
On page 15, we deleted I, which that's a requirement that 51% of the people in the district must approve of a designation of historic. That's not something that the municipal land use allows. That's a designation for that the state or the federal government has to have when they approve it. The council can't have, it can be one person or 50 people, the council has to make that judgment irregardless of the percentage. So that's not allowed per law. That just needs to be stricken. Right. We then go to page 17, and when we, on number 3, our application form is called Certificate of Appropriateness Application. So that's just a clarification from the form. In 4, we state, just like this board and the zoning board, that we require digital submissions, and Ted made some corrections and made this crystal clear, except for homeowners that are getting help from other professionals, because if a homeowner comes in and has some documentation, we will scan it for them. We don't want to make it onerous, just like we do for the planning and zoning board.
But if they have an architect or an attorney or an engineer, then they ought to be able to make the digital submission, is the point. Gotcha. But if they're coming in just by themselves, we don't require it.
Right. On page 20, the top of 20 and 22, this is a very technical change. When the commission approves a demolition, we get certain drawings of a house, and there's a whole detail of the type of drawings and the other documentation. For some reason, when we did the ordinance 6 years ago, we never required it when we deny it, because when the Historic Commission denies it, there's a whole process they can go through, an 18-month process that they can advertise, and they can still demolish it, but we didn't require the drawings. That was just an oversight, so we needed to correct that. So if we do deny it, we still get those drawings.
And you've added something on page 22.
Correct.
F to remind them that they, if they go through that process, which is from, it really starts on, at the bottom of page 20 and runs through on to 22 is the whole process for what they can do if the commission denies it. So at the very end, they have to comply with that requirement.
Correct. The only other substantial change is on the bottom of page 26, 13, archaeology. There's a requirement that any new construction at this time that they must complete a phase one archaeological study. We typically, this commission does not require that. So we're making it that they may be required as just a practice, because we don't want to be onerous to applications, so we're changing it from must to may, to just be in the practice. Those are the only substantial changes, and we would hope that the planning board would recommend this so that we can get it on the council agenda for introduction.
I had one more point that I'd made to Vince, and it has to do with the existing language, not any of the changes. If you read page 23, removal of a historic site, my point is that a historic site is a place where something happened. For instance, the Kingston Presbyterian Church Cemetery, which is where Washington and his officers had the meeting on horseback and decided to go into winter quarters at Morristown instead of going to attack New Brunswick. You can't move a site. You can move a building, a structure. And I would just suggest replacing site with structure in that section there.
Well, and while I that would require a little bit more change, because we define historic sites as also having structures and buildings.
Yeah.
And I agree with you, it's not perfect. It's kind of standard. If we were going to do that, I think we'd have to take a look at changing historic site and then giving one or two other definitions and redoing that section.
No.
I would say that you're correct. Most of the ordinance say site, because that's just the way that they do it, and it's not 100% correct. So I would say at this time, only because we really want to try to get it to council next week, I think the next time we take a look at that, maybe we can figure out how to add a couple of paragraphs to address that issue.
Yeah, all right. That makes sense, because certainly Rockingham was moved enough times, so yes, you can move structure. But
that was the structure, yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
No, Ted's correct, but, you know, and we our definition is, like I said, it's kind of standard. I would say we don't, to do that is going to take some time for us to figure out how to put that together, because there's several other sections that are involved with this definition, so.
Except occasionally, historic sites that are not buildings can be removed. When the seminary sold most of its land in New Brunswick to Rutgers and Devco, and they're now building dorms there, Herzog Hall and then later Zwemer Hall. I feel very old because I remember the last two seminary buildings. That used to be known as Holy Hill because they sat up on the hill. Well, the hill is gone. So there you go.
But the question is, where did they transfer the hill to?
Where'd the holy dirt go?
I have no idea.
Maybe it was blown up by the holy hand grenade.
So if...
Maybe Morris bought it and put it in.
Does anyone have any issue with recommending this to the council? Mike, does anyone have any issue with that? So if not, then... You don't have to make it, as long as you're fine with it, because it'll come back to you, the referral will come back to you to consider, but before we send it to council, the process is that you say it's okay, so. That's it.
Sounds good.
Okay. We're done.
Motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
All right.